Hi, I'm Laura Richards with SBI, and I'm here today with the Reigniting Small Business podcast and Patrick Lee of SBI. And today we're going to talk about when you should think about selling your business and how to achieve the outcome you desire. Patrick?
So let's start with this concept. You either went into your business in one of two ways. You either went in and you had an outcome in mind. And so you were planning that at some point I'm probably going to sell my business, or in some way you're going to transition from your business, maybe transition it to family members. You know, there was a plan in mind. And then the vast majority of you, there was no plan. You went into your business and you did the business. You were pretty successful. Things were going well. And then you hit a certain point where you realized, oh my gosh, I probably need to sell this business to get the value out of it. And I haven't even thought about that. So when to sell, when to think about selling is way earlier than most folks probably do. So we're talking probably, you know, 3, 4, 5 years before you're ready to sell. You need to really start prepping it for sale. But having an intention, knowing you're going to sell, thinking about what you'd like to sell at, what your outcome would be, having that very early on as you're building the business and designing the business is probably a key.
So Patrick, there are some major reasons why people sell. And you and I were talking about this a little bit earlier, because about 4 years ago, I sold my businesses. And some of the major reasons why people think about selling are pretty obvious, like retirement. Others are maybe from things that happened along the way that they didn't foresee, like they don't get along with their business partner, their market changed, you know, competition, those kinds of things. Somebody getting sick in the family, like roles changing at home, becoming really burned out. You're just overworked, toast, and you're like, you know what? I need to give this baby to somebody else. Boredom. Not as entertained as you once were. You have a new pet project you want to go on and figure out how to finance. And then the other aspect is just, yeah, financial opportunity. You feel like your business is in a great place and it's a good timing to look at selling and realizing that opportunity now.
Yeah, and there's another one too, and that is that you realize you've built something that has value in it as long as you're in it working. But the moment you remove yourself from it, you realize that there's no intrinsic value there. And I put everything into this. I've invested it all in there. As long as it's running and I'm there, it's working. But the moment I step away, it goes away. What do I do? Well, the first natural inclination is you sell it and get that monetary value back out of that business. But let's talk about, you did sell your business and you had reasons why you went into the business you did and why you were going to exit. What were those?
Well, so we talked about life changes as being one of those opportunities to take a look to do something different. And I've mentioned before on the podcast, and I'll mention it again, I'm a huge fan of business advisories. I think that I would probably still be working in my California tortilla franchise had I not gone to a business advisory, gotten really sound advice from my peers, and had people that listened to me over a period of time. And it was 4 or 5 years that I was in this group, who said, that's not what we hear you saying. You're talking about expanding your business, but what we hear you saying is that you're maxed out. So that was super helpful for me. So about 4 years before I sold my business, I knew my kids would be graduating high school in 4 years. And I always started my businesses with the intention that it was going to be what put my kids through college, because I didn't do any of the smart planning ahead of time for college. And so I started, you know, taking a hard look on my business instead of working in my business so much, which included getting my financials in order, staging myself for, you know, having extremely good food cost, extremely good well-managed labor costs, having effective cost-managed labor managers in the restaurant, so that someone who purchased it could do so as an absentee and still be able to realize a profit, and just really honing those numbers in a way that I hadn't before. It allowed me to be opportunistic when the right buyer, you know, appeared.
So, at what point, I mean, obviously you said you were in a advisory group and you were having conversations with the group about, you know, you in your business and then you on your business and all of that. But at what point did you seek expert advice specific to selling a business, whether a broker or, a financial, person to take a look? Like, when did they get brought in?
So I had a relationship with a broker for quite some time. I had three units and I had sold one unit after 1 year, and I maintained the relationship with that broker. So I talked to him from time to time. Also, having been through the process previously, I knew exactly what a buyer would be looking for. And I knew, because I was in a franchise, what a successful location, how they're optimized. So I think that question of optimization is one that every business needs to explore for their business practice. Are they optimized? And what is that?
Were there significant changes that were suggested to your financials to prep your books and all?
Absolutely. I had, I went from using a bookkeeper, like a, you know, one person shop bookkeeper with kind of loosey goosey reporting, to using a very specific program for restaurants. And it was much easier to control and manage my expenses when they were allocated in real time. And I was looking at real data that could be measured. And let me tell you, the part of my business I enjoyed was not the financials. So it took a lot of concerted effort on my part to sit down on a weekly, we're not talking on a monthly basis, on a weekly basis with my manager to take a look at what was happening in real time. And if safe is as specific as our food cost is high, we drilled down into it. It's our cheese cost. Hey, is everyone putting an ounce and a half of cheese on the burritos? Are you weighing them? You know, you have to get specific and granular if you're going to really optimize.
So the efficiencies in operations translated, at least in selling a restaurant, to the end result of the sale.
Absolutely, because the bottom line number, I mean, there's a lot of different aspects that go into evaluation, right? You know, do you have a rent that's affordable? Do you own the building? Do you lease the building? How long is your lease? How many years are left remaining on the lease? What are the escalation clauses in the lease? There's a lot of different aspects that go into how your business is valued, but obviously a big part of that is profit, because that's the piece that the potential purchaser can see and say, oh, well, they have this much profit. So if I go in there and insert myself as the manager and I don't use their manager, you know, they're going to immediately start tweaking it to see how they can make more profit than you. And so always setting up best case scenarios for the potential purchaser, even if it's not your scenario, is also a good thing to spend some time with your broker on.
And I think it's important to note that there's a whole lot of different folks who can play a role in prepping your business for sale and advising you. The very first business that I sold was a niche business, and it was really specific to one industry. And I found that it worked better for me to work with a transactional lawyer than it did with a broker, because I knew who my potential purchasers were. I could do that negotiating, but I needed the legal side and somebody who knew how these type of things should be structured and put together and could answer those questions. So that was my first one. But I see that most folks are using brokers. And I think the reason for that is we don't all have businesses that you could figure out very quickly. There's five folks that might purchase me, and I can go reach out to them. A lot of instances, you're depending on the broker, not just for the advice of prepping your business, but they need to know how to go find the potential buyers. So in your case, you know, you were the franchise. Did you end up with going through the franchise? Was the broker specific to going out and searching? How exactly did you find your leads?
Well, kind of like you said, I think a lot of times the broker's job is to market the listing. Like it, just like a real estate agent markets a house, that's what people use a broker for primarily, is relationships. And so in some industries, there are vertical brokers where they focus on your industry, and the restaurant industry is one of those. So I used a restaurant specific broker because that's what he did. And he had people he had sold restaurants to in the past, and he had, you know, clients that would buy multiple restaurants. So he had relationships and he knew the market. And he marketed the business. Other people who own franchises, franchisors also can bring potential buyers, you know, to bear. That is another way that businesses get sold. And real estate, there are some business real estate, you know, people like locally, I know Hyatt is one, where they sell businesses in addition to finding real estate for people and things like that. So occasionally people go that direction as well, especially when the real estate is a really good value. If you have a very low per square foot lease location and the business is selling, you might sometimes find that on the real estate side.
And I think that points out that there's different expertises needed as you prep your business for sale. There's the whole balancing your financials and your growth to your taxes and making sure that all those things line up in a way that is going to be beneficial for somebody who wishing the purchase to look at. Remember, somebody who's buying your business generally wants to see a profitable business, wants to see growth over time. Those are the type of things they're looking at. You may have spent years in your business using tax loopholes and deferring and trying to figure out how to you know, put income in places where it wouldn't be taxed right away, right? And by doing that, you're making your books and your taxes not necessarily as appealing to a potential buyer. So having somebody come in who will look at your finances and help you plot how to make those books appropriate to prep for sale, that's one piece. Second piece is the efficiencies of operations within the business, right? As Laura was talking about earlier, that whole idea that you need to make sure that you're putting it in optimum position. So anyone stepping in is stepping into the best possible place they can. It's going to make the value of the business even higher. Then you've got the whole side of real estate. You've got that whole piece of the marketing of the sale of the business. So there can be multiple expertises. And some folks, there are some brokers who say we do it all. But in some instances, you may be working with more than one expert as you head towards that destination of a sale.
Yes, I totally agree. And you should, because I mean, even from the aspect of what are you going to do with the money when the sale closes? You know, you should be seeking some financial advice if you don't already have a financial advisor, and working with someone so that when that check is turned over, you know how you're going to allocate it and where it's going to go. So I think that's an important.
And that's a very important one, because how many folks have made the mistake of not checking as to how this is going to affect taxes and what's the best way to go, and already made the mistake, you know, put the money in a spot where it must be declared and you can't do anything with it to mitigate tax burden and all that. So this is not something you stumble through. It really is something that requires a lot of guidance, a lot of expertise. It's also something that presents frequently a series of problems. You know, the cost of all this expertise, right? The cost of all this efficiency. Some businesses are profitable as designed with not a lot of fat there to play with, right? They're profitable with the owner in a operational piece. You know, it's them taking a role that they can pay themselves for. They've created themselves basically a job within the business. And so they're getting paid. But to try to take money and place it into all this expertise to get this business sold actually takes away from the value of the business or the value of the payout to the seller. So when you're at that small of a level or that tight of a margin, you can look a lot of this up. You can find books on the subject. You can do things and get yourself as prepped as possible before bringing in somebody to take the transaction to closing or, be actively out there selling. So, you know, there's different ways to approach it, and it just depends on, you know, what your resources are and what you're trying to accomplish.
So I think one thing that is kind of the elephant in the room when you talk to business owners who are looking to sell, at least 50% of the time, and I would venture actually to say a lot more than that, people want to sell their business when it's not doing well. You know, they get angry with it. They're frustrated. It's not doing what it was supposed to do. And they're like, I want to sell this business. And I'm going to say a large percentage of the time, the business is not in the shape it needs to be to sell. And by the time that the business owner has done the work of increasing their profits, consistently reviewing their financial figures to massage them and get them into good shape, to create a strong customer base, to make sure that they have longevity in their contracted space, whatever that is, whether they own it or rent it, and to create, you know, these positive forces in their business, by the time that they do that and they make it a real sellable asset, usually they're in love with their business. So that's
And there's more to that also, because I think folks feel like they go, you know what? I'm going to sell. Let's get it on the market. And in their mind, that means, okay, I'm done. In a month, 2 months, maybe 3 months, this thing will be off my plate. I will get my money and I will go home. If you talk to a broker, they're going to tell you the setup of the whole thing is 3 to 6 months, assuming your business is in the kind of shape that they can't even set it up, right? Then you go to market, and it just depends. You know, that you may go to market and find that it takes only a little bit of time to have folks making offers. But sometimes you go to market and there's another 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 months before you're getting offers that make sense to you. So this isn't something generally that you can just flip a switch and boom, okay, now it's done. This is something that needs to be planned. So I have seen folks use the sale of a business to try to exit a business that they felt was going to take a downturn. Timing is everything. And some folks do get lucky and escape bad times in the business with a sale. But more often than not, that's not what's going to happen. More often than not, it's going to be a little bit too late in the process for that business to be appealing to anybody who's buying, unless they're buying, discount assets, right? Unless they're like, okay, let's just go in and grab, it's a fire sale, we can get some value here. And you don't want to be on the other end of that. So don't waste time being prepped. If a sale is an end result and there's a timeline, you really should be prepared and working towards that over time. It's not a flip a switch type of thing. And that brings up a whole nother issue, Laura, that I think is sort of important. I think there's a lot of businesses out there, especially in the small business world, that like we said in the beginning, value is wrapped up in that business, but that's not a business that is going to sell. It's not a saleable business the way we're talking, where, you know, it's marketed out there, there's a broker, somebody's looking to buy. That's just not going to happen. A lot of that is because it's a business that's designed around a one person and their expertise, or it's a created job masquerading as a business, right? And when the person who can do that job and has those relationships and all steps away, there's no value left in the business. So in those ways, you still have to try to get the value out of that entity, right? There's still investment wrapped up in it, and the person wants to try to get that out. And so we were talking earlier about some creative ways in which you can try to sell that business or move that business to somebody else. Obviously, family is one, right? If you're passing it on in the family, But that same concept exists. Do you make a hire for your chief operating officer or the your right-hand person? Do you make a hire with the intent that, and they understand it, I'm hiring you because at some point you expressed interest in taking this business over. I have an interest in the business continuing after I step away. And so that strategic hire also allows for there to be basically a owner financed transfer or sale to a key employee.
Yeah. So, and I have a great example of that. A few years ago, I was working with a woman who was a bakery, and she had taken over the business of another woman's bakery. And it was a win-win because she was able to get a well-equipped kitchen, all of the pots, pans, and things that she needed, plus the space at a very reasonable rent. And the other, cake baker lady was able to exit the business with some money in her pocket. So it wasn't really a purchase of the business because they were different types of baked goods, but it was a transfer of the assets. And that is just another kind of sale. So I think the real thing to reiterate here for everyone listening is that even if you don't think you're ready to sell your business right now, you want to think about when it is that you will be and work backward toward it. It takes a lot longer than you think. 5 years is not too long to think ahead and think about when you might want to transition. What are your landmarks in your life and work back that way. Some of us are so happy in our businesses, we're not thinking about when we want to get out, and that's great. But for those people who do want to sell their businesses down the road, starting planning now is a great idea.
Agreed.
Well, we've spent another 20 minutes with SBI and the Reigniting Small Business Podcast. Thanks everyone for listening today.
Bye everybody.
Bye.